نحمده ونصلي ونسلم على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا صدق الله مولانا العظيم Respected brothers and sisters, it is with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are together in order to learn something that should benefit us in this world and hereafter. Today we start learning the Islamic concept of bid'ah. We'll try to keep it within three sessions, inshallah. As with anything else, I always suggest you don't discuss or study anything without defining it. Unless you define and you know what you are studying, you are not studying anything. You are not learning anything. So first of all, we go for the definition of bid'ah. Normally, people translate this as innovation. The word bid'ah comes from the Arabic word bada'a, ba, dal, and ay. Ibn Faris says in his lughat, maqayis al-lugha, ibtida'u shay'i wa sun'ihi la an mithal. To begin something and to make something without any prior example. Without any prior example. If you make something new, but it has something similar before that, so it won't be a bid'ah. Because it has to be without any prior example. La an mithal. You haven't taken it from any other example. That will make it bid'ah. Otherwise, just being new literally is not bid'ah. This literal meaning clarifies a lot of things. And Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, rahmatullah alayh, in his famous book, Fath al-Bari, Commentary on Sahih Bukhari, he says the same thing, that literally the word al-bid'atu asluha, asluha, the origin of the word bid'ah means ma uhdisa, something that has been invented ala ghayri mithalin sabiqin, without any prior example. Without any prior example. Example is not exactly the same thing. It is similar. If you do something that has something similar before you do, then your action is not bid'ah. Even literally, it is not bid'ah. It has to have no prior example. And Taj al-Urus, Imam Zabidi, Imam Murtada Zabidi al-Hanafi, he says, Arab people say, جِئْتُ بِأَمْرٍ بَدِيعٍ, I have done something badi', a muhdathin, meaning invented thing, ajib, strange, لَمْ يُعْرَفْ قَبْلَ ذَلِكَ, it was not known before that. It has no example before that. So, a lot of scholars of the language, they say this. And Quran used it in this meaning. It says, Badi'u samawati wal ard. Badi' of the heavens and the earth. It is Allah's attribute. That He has created the heavens and the earth with no prior example. There was nothing similar before that. So His creation of this universe is the bid'ah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is it because He invented or created something new? No. He created something which did not have an example before it. That's what makes Him badi'u samawati wal ard. And that's about which Quran says in Surah Al-Hadid, Surah number 57, about the monks, the Christian monks. وَرَهْبَانِيَّةً ابْتَدَعُوهَا. And the Rahbaniyya, the monasticism, ابْتَدَعُوهَا, they have invented it. They had invented it. مَا كَتَبْنَاهَا عَلَيْهِمْ. We have not obligated that upon them. So it was something with them which did not have that example before them. That is what made it bid'ah. So that is the meaning of bid'ah. And Quran says in Surah Al-Ahqaf about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma kuntu bid'am min ar-rusul." O beloved, tell them, "I am not bid'an among the messengers." I haven't brought the whole Sharia was new. A lot of things were different. The Sharia of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not the same as the Sharia of the previous prophets. There are many things which are new, and there are many things which never existed before like this. But Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are saying that I'm not a bid'ah, meaning the messengership that I have got, messengership is not something new, which did not have an example. So the word bid'ah literally has the meaning of something new, but the new does not mean just new. It means something that did not have an example before. We need to be very clear on that. And then, as a term, Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi ta'ala says, and also Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi ta'ala says, bid'at is to invent something that was not there in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And again, we need to understand, its example was not there either, because if it had an example, it has an example, then it is not bid'ah. And then Allama Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, he goes a little further in defining it. He says, not new. He says, ma khalafa al-kitaba wa sunnah aw ijma'a salafil ummah. Something that opposes the explicit Quran or the explicit sunnah, hadith, or the explicit consensus of the righteous predecessors. If something is not in opposition with express wording in Quran or hadith, and express wording from the consensus, according to Allama ibn Taymiyyah, that is not bid'ah. And he gives an example here, such as the new beliefs and the new ibadat, new acts of worship. And he gives the example then. He says, like the Kharijites and the extremist Shias. And then he mentions some other sects. So anything to suggest that a person has gone out of Ahlul Sunnah, that is bid'ah. And these things, being Kharijites and being among the Rawafid, that is something related to Aqeedah. So in the matters of Aqeedah, if something invents something that takes him out of Ahlul Sunnah, that is bid'ah, according to Allama ibn Taymiyyah. And anything lower than that, bid'ah got nothing to do with that. And then Allama ibn Rajab Hanbali rahmatullah alayh, in his famous book Jami' al-Ulum wal-Hikam, he says bid'ah means something that has been created, invented out of that which does not have a root in Sharia. Not just new, no. New thing, but it does not have any root in Sharia. Just new does not make it bid'ah. Yadullu alayhi, that refers to it. And if ma kana lahu aslun, if something has a root in Sharia, but that means the format is different, but the actual essence is there. The format is different, but the essence is there. Then in that case, falaysa bi bid'atin shar'an, it is not bid'ah according to Sharia. Even if it can be called bid'ah in literal sense, lexicon sense, but not in Shari sense, in legal sense. And he explains that further in that book. Allama ibn Hajar rahmatullah ta'ala alayhi, he says that muhdasa, this is another word in hadith, muhdasa It is something, ma uhdisa wa laysa lahu aslun fi shari, something invented and it does not have a root in Sharia. And if somebody thing has a asl, the falaysa bi bid'ah, that is not bid'ah. So bid'ah in terms of Sharia, in legal, as a legal term, is something blameworthy because it does not have a root in Sharia. And there are others, Aima, who mentioned the same thing. Now this same thing that we have taken from different Aima, from literal meaning, lexical meaning of the word bid'ah, and from the technical or legal meaning of bid'ah from the scholars. Now look at the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radhiyallahu anha narrates, Imam Muslim, Sahih Muslim, Muslim Imam Ahmad, Sunan ibn Majah, Sahih ibn Hibban, many scholars have quoted this. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Man ahdatha, whoever invented, fi amrina hadha, in this matter of ours, ma laysa minhu, which is not taken from it. Minhu, from it. It does not say that if somebody invents something, no. Invents something that cannot be taken from it. It does not have any foundation in it. That is condition there. Everywhere this condition is there. Has not been ma laysa minhu fahuwa raddun, then that should be rejected. That is a rejection. And in another narration of Sahih Bukhari and Abu Dawud, he says, ma laysa fihi, if somebody invents something in our matter, that is deen of Islam, which is not in it, it means it has a foundation there, which is not in it. How can something new be in it? Unless it means it has a root in it. So if something does not have a root in it, does not have a similar thing in it, then it is not bid'ah, then it is not rejected. So if it is not in it, then it is rejected. And there is another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Aisha Siddiqa radiyallahu ta'ala anha narrates, Sahih Muslim and Muslim Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Man amila amalan, if somebody did a deed, laysa alayhi amruna, our matter, meaning Islam, is not founded on that. Laysa alayhi, literally, our Islam is not upon it, meaning is not founded on that. It does not have a foundation in Islam. فَهُوَ رَدٌّ, then that will be a rejection. So it is conditional. Just being new does not make it unlawful. So you see, if we define something, a lot of things become clear just by defining it. And a lot of time we get confused because we don't define things. Imam Ibn Asir rahmatullah alayhi says, on the basis of this hadith, he says that the meaning of that hadith, which says that every bid'ah is a misguidance, that hadith, innama yuridu ma khalafa, that only means every bid'ah that opposes the kitab and sunnah. Not every bid'ah absolutely. That is conditional, but because of this hadith. This hadith will make that hadith conditional. It will qualify that. It will not let it remain absolute. And same is Imam Ghazali, rahmatullah alayh. He also says the meaning of ma laysa minhu, ma laysa fihi, or laysa alayhi amruna, all these three words of hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they all say that laysa kullu ma ubdi'a, every newly invented thing is not manhiyan, is not prohibited. But the manhiyu is the bid'a tudaddu, which opposes sunnatan sabitatan, an proven sunnah. There is no difference of opinion of something being sunnah and something new comes and it opposes it. Unless this happens, this new thing is not bid'ah. So we need to be very careful before we go about talking about certain things, what that particular thing is. So this is the definition. Now there is another hadith, we come to that hadith now, and we shall finish with this hadith for today. A very famous hadith, a lot of people quote it and quote. The word of the hadith is very famous, and Imam Darimi, Imam Abu Dawud, Imam Tirmizi, Ibn Majah, Imam Hakim. A lot of scholars have quoted that in the books of Hadith. And the word in that is, فَإِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ. For undoubtedly, every single muhdasa, muhdasa, newly invented thing, is a bid'ah. Every muhdasa is a bid'ah. وَكُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. And every bid'ah is misguidance. And in some narrations, there is another word, وَكُلُّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. And every misguidance goes into fire, into hell. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْهَا. And you must have heard maybe thousands of times this particular hadith. Now let's today study the full hadith. We are today going to study the full hadith. Full hadith says, Imam Abu Dawud narrate, and Irbad bin Sariyah radiallahu anhu says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam led us a prayer on one day. Then he faced towards us and he gave us admonishment, very deep admonishment, which made eyes shed tears, which made eyes flow, and the hearts tremble. And some of them said, some of the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, كَأَنَّ هَذِهِ مَوْعِظَةُ مُؤَدِّعٍ فَمَا تَعْحَدْ. As if it is a farewell admonishment, meaning it's the last one. You address us in a way that we feel that it is your last address. So would you like to advise us something? Make any promise with you, so that we make any promise with you? Holy Prophet ﷺ replied, Usikum, I advise you, bi taqwa Allah, to take the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one. Number two, wassami'i wa ta'a, and obey your khalifa after me. Obey my khalifa. وَإِنْ عَبْدَ الْحَبْشِيَنْ. Even if it was an Abyssinian slave, a black slave, if he is your Amir, obey him. Now he says, فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ. Remember, beware, anybody of you who will live after me, after I go, there will be people alive among you. So he is talking directly to the companions, which specifies the time of this word. When this word, this bid'ah, this muhdasa will come. فَسَيَرَىٰ إِخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. He will see a lot of discord. فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي. So you get hold of my sunnah. وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. And the sunnah of my khulafa, khulafa-i rashideen, khilafat-i rashida. So that means, Holy Prophet ﷺ is going to mention something related to the time of Khulafa-i Rashideen, not to the time after that. That specifies the time span, limitizes it. And then, تَمَسَّكُوا بِهَا وَعَدُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِزِ. Hold of, have a hold on, get hold of it with your teeth. وَإِيَّاكُمْ. And protect yourself from مُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ, from the invented things. So Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he's doing here, he is also bringing the muhdathat al-umur in contrast with following the Khulafa-i Rashideen. So these muhdathat al-umur, these newly invented things, are related to the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Uthman, and Sayyidina Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, and Sayyidina Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, three different words to specify this time span. Then he says, every newly invented thing in your time, in the time of Khulafa-i Rashideen, that will be a bid'ah. And every bid'ah, that it goes, the rest of the world you know. So doesn't that specify the time span? So shouldn't we look at the meaning of this word? Imam Tirmidhi narrated, many books of hadith have this hadith, different wording. You know, but the meaning is same. And in one narration, Imam Bukhari narrates that hadith, Holy Prophet ﷺ said, on the day of judgment, I will be waiting for you, I will be your preparation there on the Hawd, on the Kawthar. And some of you will be brought to me, Now he specifically mentions those who are known to be Sahaba at that time. Some of them are old, some of them, they became Muslim right at the time of the, after the Hijjatul Wada. They were not very strong in their Iman. So it includes all of them. And they will be brought to me, in front of me, and they will be stopped from coming to me. And I will say, Ya Rabbi Ashabi, O my Lord, my Ashab, my companions. And it will be said, you do not know what they have invented newly after you go, after you went. And in some narrations, don't you know what they invented after you? And some narration explain it further. And the angel will say, they became apostate after you passed away. So this hadith clarifies the meaning of those bid'at which are related to making people into apostate, making people into kafir again. They are related to aqidah, and there were many in those days. Many. And so Holy Prophet ﷺ confined that to the time of Khulafa Rashideen, and then he confined them to the act of becoming murtad, to the act of becoming apostate, becoming kafir again after Iman, na'udhu billahi min dhalik. And same is the, in many, Sunan ibn Majah has the same wording. And in one narration, Imam Hakim narrates, the wording is, عَلَيْكُمْ بِمَا تَعْرِفُونَ مِنْ سُنَّةِ نَبِيِّكُمْ وَالْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. Then get hold of that which you know from the Sunnah of your Prophet and Al-Khulafa al-Rashideen. Just stick to them. Don't oppose the Khulafa al-Rashideen. And Bukhari, Muslim, many of the scholars have taken this hadith. And the word in the hadith of Bukhari, إِنَّ هَؤُلَاءِ لَمْ يَزَالُوا مُرْتَدِّينَ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِهِمْ مُنْذُ فَارَقْتَمْ. The moment you left, they are the ones who turned back on their feet towards kufr. They became murtad. And مَا زَالُوا مُرْتَدْ. They continued to be murtad. They continued to be apostate and kafir after you went. مُنْذُ فَارَقْتَمْ, from the moment you left. So this specifies the whole, it changes the whole scenario of these words. How can you apply these words which mention the kufr, which mention the irtidad of the time of Khulafa'i Rashideen? How can you apply that on the daily things that we do? That's twisting the meaning of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ma'azallah. And a lot of people in our time do that. Say Muslims word is the same, innahum lam yazalu murtaddina ala aqabihim mundu faraqtahum. From the moment you left them, they became apostate, and they continued to be apostate. And Imam Bukhari rahmatullah in his sahih, it's very significant. What does he understand from this hadith? We need to ask ourselves. And we find Imam Bukhari rahmatullah, Muhammad bin Yusuf al-Firabri, the narrator of Bukhari, from Sahih Bukhari, from Imam Bukhari. He says, ذُكِرَ عِنْدَ أَبِي عَبْدِاللَّهِ عَنْ قُبَيْصَةَ. Abi Abdullah, yani Imam Muhammad bin Ismail Bukhari rahmatullah, Imam Bukhari, in front of him, from Qubaysa it was mentioned. And Qubaysa said, هُمُ الْمُرْتَدُّونَ. They are the apostates. الَّذِينَ ارْتَدُّوا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِ أَبِي بَكْرٍ, who became apostate, became kafir again in the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. فَقَاتَلَهُمْ. Then he had a fight against them. He had to fight against them. He fought against them. So Imam Bukhari mentions that the meaning does not apply on us in our time, on everyday deeds, on minor things. It is related to the being murtad of that time. And they are Khawarij. They are Khawarij. Because Imam Ibn Hajar Asqalani and Ibn Abdul Barr mention, Ibn Abdul Barr says, and Imam Hakim also mentioned that, Hussein bin Kharija is a Tabi'i. He says, when there was a fitna, and they find the first big fitna, There are two things. Number one, the apostate, people became apostate. And second thing was the fitna of Kharijites that appeared at the time of Uthman Ghani radiallahu ta'ala. So these are the two applications of this hadith. And in the time of the Sahaba, in the time of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there were, number one fitna, there were people who claimed prophecy, who said, we are also prophets. And number one of them, Aswad Ansi. Another one is Tulayha Asadi. And the third one, very famous, Musaylima Al-Kadhab. And the fourth one, a lady, Sajah bint Harisa. These are the four people who claimed prophecy after the demise of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sayyidina, this, and a lot of people were caught by them. They followed them. They became apostate. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu had to fight against them. This is one thing. And there were people who said zakat is not obligated on us anymore. And denial of the zakat, ma'azallah, is an act of disbelief. So they became apostate by that. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu had to fight against them. And the third main thing that came during the Khilafat Rashida is the appearance of Kharijites. And Kharijites came, and they were known as Hururiya as well. Their fitna, and they appeared in the time of Sayyidina Uthman Ghani radiallahu ta'ala first time, and they are the ones who killed Sayyidina Uthman Ghani radiallahu ta'ala. And then in the form of proper army and rebels, they came in time of Sayyidina Ali Murtada radiallahu ta'ala. And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala had fights against them. He had to fight, literally fight against them. And the first bid'ah that they had, the first bid'ah in the history of Islam, which is the bid'ah of disbelief, which is the meaning of this particular hadith, that every newly invented thing is a bid'ah. Every bid'ah is a misguidance, and every misguidance leads to fire. This particular hadith is related to these things. If somebody applies this particular wording to the daily deeds that we do, like to Al-Mawlid, like to A'ras, Urs of Awliya, like to the gatherings to mention the Awliya and to commemorate Awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If anyone applies this particular hadith to these minor things, he is twisting the meaning of hadith. Because hadith does not apply to these things. It applies to the matters which lead to disbelief. Rejecting any article of iman, like the existence of Allah, or the finality of the prophecy of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rejecting any of the fundamental pillars of Islam, like rejecting zakat, ma'azallah, or saying that ma'azallah, that salat is not obligated on me, ma'azallah. Saying something of that nature. If something is of this nature, then this goes with the first and initial application of this hadith in the time of Khulafa Rashidin. Or like Kharijites did, they established a new everything, a new mazhab. And they separated from Ahlul Sunnah. So leaving Ahlul Sunnah, like Allama Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned, Al-Khawarij, Al-Rawafid, he mentioned them. Going out of Ahlul Sunnah, that is the application of this hadith, which is quoted and quoted and quoted. Applying this hadith on these minor matters that I just mentioned, like Mawlid, and the mention of the Awliya, or Isalu Sawab, reciting Fatiha for the deceased ones. Applying this hadith on these matters is clear twisting of the meaning of the hadith. These matters are not even bid'ah. They are not even bid'ah, because we have known the meaning of bid'ah, that even if the format may be different, but the foundation is there, that is not bid'ah. That cannot be declared, neither literally nor legally. neither lughatan nor shar'an. So today we try to understand the meaning of bid'ah and the application of that particular hadith that is quoted and quoted and quoted and applied on the matters that do not belong to that hadith. Another, the word itself, if we take it out of the context as well, even then the word that says it will lead to hellfire, you know, hellfire only confirmed for disbelief. So it would mean something that leads to disbelief. Even the word itself leads there. Even if it, after it has been taken from the context, even then the word, which, because you see two different natures. One says, if something is not based on this, on Islam, that is rejected. It's a very minor thing. And this one says it goes to fire. So that is rejected is related to deeds. And goes to fire is related to the acts of murtaduna, act of irtidad, act of apostasy. The very different, you can see the nature of the statement. They fall apart. So this is very important point that we need to keep in our minds before we study the meaning of before study the bid'ah and what is bid'ah and what is not. And we shall study further, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us proper understanding and following. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ